Okay, I am going to give you an introduction to our next topic, which is it's called the space topic, but there's so much more to it than that. This is going to be an exciting way to end our course. So we're going to start today with an introduction to basically what's up there in space. And you can ask me any questions if you want to. And then what we'll do is over the course of the rest of the topic, which is only a short one, it'll just take us 2 weeks or so. We'll finish somewhere around about half term, either side of it, one or the other. And once we've seen what's up there, we'll have a look at how we know what's up there, some of the rules, some of the laws, the physical laws that are describing and explaining how things move and how things are. We'll take a look at some stars and some galaxies. And ultimately, we'll try to find our way to the actual origin of the universe itself. But for today, we're just going to take a kind of tour through the pictures. If you want to unmute at any point and ask a question, feel free to do so. What you've just watched on that video is a kind of CGI version of these pictures. So these pictures and ones like it have been taken by real telescopes, and then they were stitched together to make the introduction to a film called Contact, which in an ordinary year I would show to students because it's such a good film. It's got Jodie Foster in it. It was made by one of the big studios in America. It's a really good film. But the introduction gives you a flyby some of the objects that are out there in space. And so we're going to work through them at a slightly slower pace now and have a little look at what's up there in the sky. So we're going to start with this picture, which is what you see when you look up at night, and you can see that there are some bright sparkles in the sky, and those you know full well are called stars. And with the naked eye, you can see a few hundred maybe. If you go somewhere really dark and let your eyes adjust, you might get up to a few thousand. We've been looking at the stars most of human history. In fact, at the moment, with streetlights around and our busy lives and living indoors and having all electronics to occupy our time, we're probably looking at the sky less now than we have for the entirety of human history, unless you're an astronomer, of course. So I don't know when the last time you looked up was, but make sure that you find an opportunity to do so while it's still wintertime, because in a couple more months, lovely as the summer is going to be, the nights are going to be very short and you're not going to see very many stars. So why not get yourself out there one night this week when it's dark and the skies are clear and see what you can see up in the sky? During human history, we've looked up and made patterns in the sky. It's just playing dot to dot with the stars. So this pattern is in the sky right now over your heads. Well, it will be tonight. This is Orion. You can spot it by the three distinctive stars across the belt. And then there are four very bright stars making the corners of this shape. It's been given the name Orion, which is a hunter, and you can see the bow sticking out on the side of the image there. And over the course of history, we have kind of romanticized space by not really understanding what we're looking at, and not just playing dot to dot, but attributing entire stories to these dot to dot shapes in the sky. And sometimes seeing things, you've got to be generous. I mean, is that a goat, really? That kind of triangly shape? So we've always made up stories about sky, but it's only been in the last few decades that we've had amazing telescopes that can seriously see what we're looking at. But even before telescopes, we could tell some things from the stars beyond making up stories. This is a picture of the night sky. If you kind of leave the shutter on the camera open, just pointing at the sky, and you can see the rotation effect around that dot in the middle. And even ancient astronomers understood that the sky rotated, and that the most likely reason for this was because the Earth itself was rotating under a sky of fixed stars. And so you can discern the rotation of the Earth by observing the stars. The point in the middle, There is actually a star pretty much near the center of that point. It's called Polaris, the pole star. It's pretty much above the northern axis of the Earth. And so when we look up in the northern hemisphere, it appears to be the point in the sky that we're rotating around. And certainly if you're ever lost in the wilderness of the Arctic, because obviously you will be one day, you can always try to find Polaris and that will point north. Okay, so that's kind of what you can see with your naked eye, but we have come a long way since. So we have got all kinds of groovy telescopes, both earthbound and in orbit. And so let's take a look at some pictures that we can see with some technology. The first one might be slightly surprising if you've never looked. That's what the sun looks like up close with a really good camera. It does look a lot like a ball of fire because it is a lot like a ball of fire. Now, it isn't a chemical fire. Nothing is combusting. There's no oxygen and there's no big lump of coal or anything like that. We have actually learned what's going on inside that star. It's nuclear fusion, and we will be returning to the processes that occur within a star in an entire lesson shortly. But it is important to note that this extraordinarily large ball of hot plasma, protons and electrons, the core of which fusing to release all that heat and light, that is a star. And our nearest star to the Earth is the Sun. It is around about 150 million kilometers from us. And even traveling at the speed of light, that is 8 minutes away, which means if some crazy weird thing happened to the sun right now, we wouldn't know about it for another 8 minutes. It's a long way away, and it's very, very big. You could fit the Earth across there about 300 times. So if that's what a star looks like when we're quite close to it, maybe it's not such a stretch to think that if we could visit any of the other points of light in the sky that are just so far away that they just look like little dots, if we could go visit any of them, they would look like this. And our sun looks just like a dot from far away. So the first image, therefore, the sun, a star, a big ball of fusing hydrogen. Planets. This one is the one closest to the sun. It's Mercury. Side of it gets scorched during its day, and the dark side of it freezes against the night sky. It has no atmosphere, so the sun side can get up to above 500 degrees, and the cold side can get down to about minus 270 degrees. You couldn't live there. The hot side is too hot and the cold side is too cold. You would need to get some kind of city on wheels that trundled around the Terminator, which is the line between day and night, constantly in twilight. Mercury is probably made of lots of heavy metals. So maybe one day, if we ever run out of metals to mine on Earth, maybe we want to make ourselves a fleet of galactic spaceships or something like that, and we need a lot of metals. Maybe we'll need to go and mine some from Mercury. This is Venus. Venus is around about the same size as the Earth and believed to have had roughly the same composition of elements of the Earth, but it's a bit too close to the sun. And that extra amount of heat kept the core and the surface of Venus molten. So whereas the Earth's crust has sealed the magma inside, Venus continues to belch out all kinds of toxic chemicals like sulfur dioxide. The surface is perpetually volcanic and covered in lava. And all of the sulfur dioxide and the carbon dioxide that the volcanoes and the lava belch out into the atmosphere has created a runaway greenhouse effect, which means that the surface of Venus is up at hundreds of degrees. It's the nightmare scenario of climate change gone bad. I don't think the Earth is close enough to the Sun for this to ever occur to Earth, but it does give us a sneaky peek into a hellish future of what could be if we were just a little bit closer to the Sun. It rains sulfuric acid, and the pressure of the atmosphere is almost as much as an ocean. So it's not hospitable. We're never going to go and live there. It is your stereotypical vision of hell. Then we come to the third planet out. This is a very famous photograph. This is Earthrise. It was taken by one of the Apollo astronauts in the 70s. It is claimed to be the most viewed, most printed image of all time. That's the claim anyway. Taken on the moon, 50 years, 60 years ago with the world's first handheld camera. It's not a bad photo. And just like the moon appears to rise sometimes and we have phases of the moon, here are phases of the Earth. Earth is often regarded as being in what's called the Goldilocks zone. It's just close enough to the Earth to warm us and keep the oceans liquid, but not too far from the Earth to allow the oceans to freeze. And that ability to have liquid water on the surface of our planet is what is making the Earth such a very special place. Don't worry, Ethan, we're just in the middle of a photo show. Okay, moving further out, this is Mars. Mars is significantly smaller than the Earth, which means that the gravity on the ground there is about a third of the gravity on the Earth. So if you were to go for a walk on Mars, you would stay on the ground, which is good, but you'd be able to do some really cool jumping and running. Mars does have a tenuous atmosphere. It's largely carbon dioxide, believed to be some liquid water, well, frozen water that we could perhaps liquefy if we decided to go to Mars one day. The surface is scored by huge craters from meteorite crashes and this immense canyon, which would dwarf the Grand Canyon. Mars also has the solar system's largest volcano, which is dormant, but would dwarf Mount Everest. So Mars is a planet of extremes, but no atmosphere. It is, however, most likely to be the first planets that we will choose to visit because it is hospitable. We could survive there if we took some food and some water. Mars is about 18 months away on current technology, and NASA does have in its pipeline plans to send human visitors to Mars during your lifetime. Once you get beyond Mars, you pass through a rocky region of the solar system known as the asteroid belt, which is lots and lots and lots and lots of very large rocks ranging from the size of cars up to mountains that are orbiting around the sun. But once you pass through the asteroid belt, you reach the outer solar system, and there the planets are made of the lighter elements that gravity never pulled together into the inner planets. We'll talk more about that when we talk about the origin of the sun. What's left, therefore, are the lighter gases. And so the planets don't have solid surfaces. They're the gas giants. Lots of hydrogen and helium, and they're very, very large because as gases, they can spread out a little bit. This is Jupiter. And that kind of orangey patch in the middle is actually a hurricane, first observed by astronomers over 350 years ago. So it is a very long, long storm, 350 years old at least. You could fit the Earth inside that the eye of that hurricane, so it's very, very big. Not hospitable. As a gas giant, you just sink through the surface until you fell deep enough for it to crush you with its pressure. It would also be very cold. But orbiting around Jupiter are a handful of moons, including four big ones. And one of them, Ganymede, is possibly a second place to Mars. It's just a little bit further away, but big enough to have some gravity, possibly an atmosphere. And it's warmed by Jupiter. Jupiter has one known called tidal effects, like the moon pulls on our oceans and makes the oceans bulge up. Jupiter's gravity pulls on its moons and squashes and stretches and squashes and stretches and squashes and stretches. And this constant frictional effect on the moons warms the moons. So actually, Ganymede, we got our eye on Ganymede as a possible location to head for after we've done Mars, because it's possibly going to be warm, possibly going to have an atmosphere, possibly going to have enough gravity to keep us on the surface. We quite like the idea of Ganymede. Moving further out, we have Saturn with its famous rings, which are largely chunks of ice. It has about 60 little moons flying around. So many moons that we keep finding new ones every now and again. And there's an incredible amount of maths that goes into exactly why the rings are the shape they are and why they seem to have gaps in the middle of them. So if you like your maths and you like your astronomy, you might want to go have a look at the rings of Saturn. Uranus is so far away, it's difficult to get very good pictures of it. It appears as just a big blue dot in the sky, as does Neptune, which are the two outermost planets. Beyond Neptune, we have Pluto, which used to be a planet until about 15 years ago when astronomers decided that we couldn't keep calling it a planet because they discovered some other Pluto-sized objects in the solar system. And they were worried that if we kept looking enough with our new improved cameras, then we would find lots and lots and lots of these objects, and suddenly we would go from having 9 planets to having like 20 planets, which they just felt was ridiculous. And Pluto is on the verge of what we would call a planet, so much so that it has been reclassified as something called a dwarf planet. So trying to be a planet, but not quite succeeding. The criteria to make it to be a planet would be that it should have had enough gravity to pull itself into a spherical shape. Pluto is a little bit lumpy. It hasn't quite made it into a spherical shape. Pluto hasn't cleared its orbit of debris either. So as Pluto makes its way around the sun, it's still regularly bumping into bits of rock. All the other planets mopped up all the little bits of rock out of their orbits millions of years ago, but poor little Pluto doesn't have enough gravity to do it. There are other Pluto-sized objects in the solar system. Please feel free to Google the dwarf planets. So all of that you should remember from year 7. We've already been through this once in your education. I'm just giving you a very quick tour. But this is more about how we know these things rather than what it is we know about the solar system. So how do we know these things? Well, we have actually visited at least one place in the solar system ourselves. In the 1970s, we sent people to the moon. I can't remember exactly how many it is, but I think there's something like 16 humans have walked on the moon. And then we kind of discovered in the 1970s that, exciting as it was as a voyage of exploration, there wasn't really anything there. It's kind of just a big rock. And so there was no impetus to stay there. It is so expensive, space travel. And when we went to the moon and found it to be just a rock, we kind of came back again, and we haven't been back since because there wasn't the technology to sustain a moon base. However, right now, NASA are planning for a permanent moon base. And so maybe you could go train with NASA and become an astronaut and be one of the first people to have a permanent station on the moon. But that is the only place we've sent humans. Beyond that, we send a whole load of probes and rovers. So Mars, I've lost count of the number of satellites that are in orbit around Mars taking pictures. If you didn't know that, by all means, do some Googling and find out all the probes that we've sent to the various planets in the solar system. But Mars is closest and is the most interesting to us because it might be a future location. So we've also sent rovers. One of them, I can't remember its name. They all sound similar names to me. One of them is about to land on Mars in the next couple of weeks. It's on close approach now. So I can't, like I say, I can't remember what its name is. But if you just Google Mars probe, you'll find that, there is a touchdown imminent. And it's a little bit hair-raising when we land these things on other planets because there's not a lot of atmosphere. So the parachutes don't work a great deal. rockets and boosters need to be controlled by the device itself rather than people from the ground because it takes a lag of a few minutes to send a signal. Perseverance, thank you very much. There have been rovers trundling around on Mars for the best part of 20 years, and they have taken rock samples and done experiments. They have never discovered anything that would be indicative of life, but they have discovered lots of smoothed stones and the kind of geological formations that we find on Earth due to running water. So it is believed that once upon a time there was water running on Mars. In fact, the first astronomers to observe Mars saw channels, and the astronomer was Italian, and he referred to them as channels, but the Italian word for channel is canali, which the British press translated incorrectly as canals. That led to the whole H.G. Wells Martians are coming to get us War of the Worlds thing. And to this day, you will find people on the planet who believe in Martians, but the rovers have been trundling around and found no evidence of life. Probes, as I said, have been flying all around the solar system. This one is the most famous of them all. This is Voyager. There are actually two Voyagers, one and two. We launched them in the 70s and sent them off on a tour of the solar system. And some of the photos that I sent you, that I showed you earlier, are photos that Voyager took. Voyager 1 and 2 left the solar system, famously, a few years ago. We sent them on their merry way. And it took them 40 years to reach the edge of the solar system, which is way past Pluto. Pluto is about the first tenth of the solar system, and then the next nine tenths beyond that is just a whole load of dust and gas, until eventually we reach an area which is right on the edge of where the gravity of the sun can hang on to little bits of dust anymore. And as it passes through this region, it's technically now in interstellar space. So Voyager 1 and 2 are sailing between the stars at the moment. But before Voyager left the solar system, it turned round and it took a picture. And this picture is known as the pale blue dot, and that is Earth from the edge of the solar system, just as a beam of light happened to catch it from the sun in just the right way. This image is just loved by poets, I guess. It just reminds us that everything that has ever been is in that pixel of light, which is frightening a little bit, I guess. So what do we see from the ground through telescopes? Well, the actual sky contains a whole load more stars in it than we can see with our naked eye, tens of thousands of them. And in actual fact, if you really do go somewhere dark enough and you lie there with your eyes open to night adjust long enough, somewhere in the middle of a desert or an ocean somewhere, you see this object in the sky. So you can see all the stars, but in the middle of the stars, there is this pattern across the middle of the sky. It reaches from one horizon straight over your head to the other horizon. The ancients believed that one of the gods had tripped and spilt an urn of milk across the sky, And so this object is known as the Milky Way, which seems a ridiculous name for it now, considering that this is where we live. Our sun is floating around in space in a kind of blob of other stars. The blob needs a proper name, so it's called a galaxy. And so we live inside the Milky Way galaxy. And what you're looking at in this picture is what you see from basically, if you were inside a marshmallow and you were trying to see out of the marshmallow, you'd just be looking at a lot of marshmallow. Well, we are embedded in a cloud of stars, basically. And what you're looking at there is the stars that we're trying to see through. It looks like a cloud, but it's not a cloud. It's a very, very large number of stars. And we'll come back to that in a second. First observations were done with telescopes that were little more than a tube with a lens at each end. But these days, they're motorized and computerized, and they're building sized, and we put them on top of mountains so that there's as little atmosphere and as few clouds in the way as possible. These are on Hawaii, which is a nice place to work if you want to go be an astronomer. However, like I say, skeleton crew, because everything is computerized and robotic these days. Closer to home, you might recognize this. This is the Lovell telescope at Jodrell Bank. It is worth noting that you live within 5 miles of the fifth best telescope on the planet. And if you have never visited the visitor center, if you've never had a picnic underneath the dish, you owe it to yourselves to do that this summer, if lockdown allows us to. Fifth best telescope on the planet in your back garden. Go have a look at it. You might notice that it doesn't look much like a lens. We have studied the electromagnetic spectrum, and we have seen that there are all kinds of lights floating around the place, not just the ones that human eyes can see. And so this particular telescope is observing radio waves, and it is radio astronomy that allows us to see furthest into the universe at large, to see what's out there. A slightly larger dish, but not one on a gantry, so it can't be moved, is actually this one, which is the top of an extinct volcano, which has just been kind of smoothed over with some concrete, and then they've dangled the telescope above it so that the radio waves come into the ground, bounce off the concrete, and go up into that thing that's hanging above it. This is Arecibo in Puerto Rico. And Arecibo has been one of the greatest telescopes that we have ever had access to. Unfortunately, the geology of the site has become unstable. And there have been numerous rock falls over the last couple of decades. And the government in Puerto Rico have decided that it is no longer safe for the astronomers to be there. And certainly that means it's not going to be maintained anymore. As the landfalls come down and destroy bits of the dish, it's no longer going to be repaired. So it's just been announced last month that Arecibo is going to be left to go back to the jungle, which is a sad, sad day, because it's been providing us with pictures for the last 60 years. This is the future, though. Tens of thousands of tiny little satellite dishes, not that much bigger than the one you might have on the side of your house. Bit bigger, but not that much bigger. About the size of a car. And instead of building these huge telescopes, astronomers have worked out that the picture in front of you kind of looks like a really big telescope with kind of holes in it. And obviously having a hole in your telescope isn't good, but what it means is that once that was realized, that we could stitch individual little telescopes together using computers and combine the images from all of them as if they were part of an enormous dish, then astronomers got very excited indeed and started having conversations with all of their nerdy IT professionals about how they could link the dishes up. And so this is one site that is currently being built in South Africa, but it is one site of many. And the plan is to start spreading these sites all across an entire continent and to produce a telescope that is effectively the size of a continent. When this dish is complete, think of it as one big dish with a very large number of holes in the middle of it, where all the red dots are not. But when this dish is complete, it will have the ability to see to such an extent that, to give you an analogy, if you were to have it at your disposal here in Macclesfield and you pointed it at New York, you would be able to count the hair follicles on a person's head while they were standing being a tourist on the Empire State Building. It will be the greatest telescope ever made, and it will allow us to see further into the universe in greater detail than we have ever seen. It is going to be a very exciting day, and to make it even sweeter for you residents of Macclesfield, its global headquarters and the center of operations is Jodrell Bank. So if you wanted to work on this dish, you live in the right place. You just down the road from its operational headquarters. It's called the Square Kilometre Array. Next time you drive past Jodrell Bank, look for the signs. But why make your dishes on the ground when you can put them in space and have no atmosphere at all above you? This is the Hubble Space Telescope, launched in 2005, I think, with a lifetime expected to be about 10 years, 15 at the best, still going strong. Slightly embarrassingly, you can see the opening at the left-hand side of this picture. That's where the light goes in. And inside there is a mirror that collects the light and reflects it onto the optics to take the picture. Quite embarrassing for everyone involved. NASA in America built some of the Hubble Space Telescope, and the European Space Agency over here built some of the rest of the telescope. And when they were communicating with each other, a pair of engineers sent each other some schematics for the inside of the telescope. And being ever so slightly naughty, neither engineer decided to include any units on the drawings. And so the Europeans, working in millimeters, sent it to the Americans, who were working in inches, and neither one of them kind of did what seems obvious now. And so when they built the telescope and put it into space before they noticed, they opened the front window to this big champagne-filled room full of the world's press, and the vision was all blurry. Because the optics were installed in the wrong place, because somebody had taken the centimeters and turned them into inches. It cost close to $1 billion to send up astronauts to fix the thing, almost as much as it took to make the thing in the first place. It was not NASA's greatest day. But since then, it has produced the greatest photography of astronomy ever. It has its own website, hubblesite.org, and there are tens of thousands of high-resolution images on there, a lifetime's worth of observing from the Hubble Space Telescope. It is, however, old technology and we can do better. And this is the James Webb Telescope, which is currently 95% finished in various facilities around the world. And it is just entering the phase now where it is all shipped to the same location and put together and bundled onto a rocket. And at some point in the next year or two, this thing should be launched into space. It is immense, and it will be better than Hubble by a factor of 100 or so. And these telescopes are visible light telescopes. So they're the ones that send back all the groovy photographs. So we look forward to the James Webb Telescope going into orbit. Keep your eye on the news for stories about the James Webb Telescope. So what have they seen? Hubble and others like it. This is what a galaxy looks like. This is a real photograph. It's not a photograph of our galaxy because we're inside our galaxy, and so we can't take a picture from the outside of it. This is a picture of the Andromeda galaxy, which is our nearest galaxy, or our nearest big galaxy. It's flat, plate-shaped, spinning. Doesn't spin very fast. Takes about a million years to spin once, which is pretty slow, but then the thing is enormous. So how do we know, first of all, that our galaxy looks like this? Well, astronomers are very, very clever, and they can point their telescopes at all of the stars that we can see, and they know how far away they are, and so they can kind of make a map of the stars from the inside of the galaxy. And as they've made up the map, it looks a lot like this one. So this is an actual photograph, but their computer simulation looks the same. It is a collection of 100 billion stars. 100 billion suns. Just let that sink in for a minute. 100 billion places like our sun. We used to think that planets were rare, but when our telescopes got good enough, we started seeing them around all of the stars, nearly all the stars. So not just 100 billion stars, but maybe 100 billion planets. Maybe 1,000 billion planets if they've all got 10. Think about that. 100 billion planets, 100 billion other places where there might be life. Now, it's not as simple as that. And in the 1950s or 60s, an astronomer called Frank Drake, started trying to play with the numbers about how likely it might be that there would be life on other planets. And he said, well, let's kind of take a statistical approach. Let's just say something like, I don't know, 1% of the stars have planets. And maybe 1% of those have Earth-like planets. And maybe 1% of those ever gave rise to life. And maybe 1% of those gave birth to intelligent life. And maybe 1% of those gave birth to inquisitive life that might develop technology and one day leave their planet and go for a walk in the solar system, in the Milky Way galaxy. Now, all those 1% of 1% of 1% of 1% start adding up to a really small fraction, but then it's a really small fraction of 100 billion. And when Drake was finished, he reckoned that there was a reasonable chance that the lowest number was 10. As in, a reasonable chance that we were not alone. But then he started doing some other calculations, and he said, well, if we got in our spacecraft and we started flying around, how long would it take? So the nearest star to the sun is called Proxima Centauri, and it's 4 light years away. That's the distance that light travels in a year, times 4. It's quite a long way. Voyager is going to take 70,000 years to travel that distance. So humans aren't going to travel very fast. However, Voyager was launched 40, 50 years ago, and technology has come on, and astronomers and engineers have had some bright ideas about how they can make better spacecraft. And it's a reasonable thought that one day within the next couple of hundred years, we might be able to produce spacecraft that can maybe travel at about 10% the speed of light. In which case, it would take us about 40 years to get to the nearest star. And say we get there and we hang around for a decade or so, and then we push on to the next star, and the next star, and the next star, and the next star. How long would it take for us to visit every star in the solar system? I don't mean one at a time. I mean, every time we land on a new star, we scatter in 10 different directions and do it again and again and again. How long would that take? It turns out that the Milky Way is about 50,000 light years across, which is quite big, you have to say. 50,000 years to go from one side of the Milky Way to the other. Which incidentally means that if you look through a telescope at a star on the other side of the Milky Way, you're seeing light as it left that star 50,000 years ago, not now. So it turns out that if we could travel at 10% the speed of light, it would take something like 500,000 to 1,000,000 years to colonize the entire Milky Way galaxy. Now, 500,000 to 1,000,000 years sounds like a very long time, until you appreciate that the galaxy and the solar system has existed for nearly 5,000 million years. Which means there have been 5,000 to 10,000 times the length of time needed for a intelligent species to colonize the galaxy. And when I say colonize the galaxy, I mean everywhere. I mean, we'd look up at the stars and we'd see spaceships whizzing around. We would see signals zipping around and our telescopes would pick them up. They would be here in the solar system, colonizing our moons, taking the metals, mining the metals for new ships. Maybe the stars would go dark because they would build huge solar collectors around the stars to collect all of the energy and be ultra efficient with their solar energy. They'd be here. And I mean be here in colonies. I don't mean be here in a spaceship, bizarrely landing in the middle of Utah, disemboweling a cow and randomly impregnating American women. So did you know that the average IQ of people who have seen UFOs is well below average, and that 90% of all UFO sightings are all in America? Seems a bit weird statistically to me. So Drake concluded that actually we might be alone. Maybe life is way, way less likely than we think. Or at the slightly pessimistic other end of the spectrum, life is really common, but something weird keeps happening in the galaxy that kind of kills everything. That's not a very nice thing to think of. Either way, the point is, there are a vast number of stars out there and a vast number of planets. And although it is going to take us a very long time to explore, that is our destiny. One more slide. This is called the Hubble Ultra Deep Field. Over the period of a year or so, once per orbit, the Hubble Space Telescope was pointed at a patch of the sky roughly the size of 1 square millimeter as you look at it from the ground. And once a day for about a year, it would take an exposure of this point of the sky and collect a tiny little bit of light. And then a day later, as it swung around again, it would add a little bit more light and a little bit more light, a little bit more light. Eventually, after about 11 hours worth of exposure time, over a period of just over a year. This picture was established. Every patch of light in this photograph is a galaxy. In this photograph alone, there are 10,000 galaxies. Each of those galaxies contains 100 billion stars. And this is just a patch of sky 1 millimeter square. It would take 52 million photographs like this one to cover the sky, which means conservatively, just at a rough minimum guess, there are something like 50,000 billion stars in the observable universe. And we are sat on a rock orbiting just one of them out of 50,000 billion stars. And you have to ask yourself, are the odds so slight that they're one in 50,000 billion that life would arise? I don't think you will find an astronomer anywhere on the planet who believes that we're alone. The question is merely, how far away are the others? I'd also like you to reflect on the fact of how very, very, very small we are. A tiny little rock around a tiny little star that is one out of 100 billion in a galaxy, where the galaxy itself is just one out of maybe 500 billion in the sky. So very small. And yet everything that has ever happened has happened here. And so despite the fact that we are so very small and so very insignificant, this is everything. This is the whole of humanity on this rock. And so try to balance in your head this competing idea of the vastness of space and the smallness of us, and contrast that against the enormity of us, the only known intelligent life in the universe, and the fact that all of it is in exactly the same place, which does give you a glimpse into NASA's thinking when they want to get some of us onto a different planet. Right, we're going to pick this up next lesson. If you do nothing else, at least have a browse of hubblesite.org and see some more photographs.